the manager at Union Building. She's also the vice president of Caterpillar and co-manager. Co-manager, yeah. Film music. Yes, fantastic. So this is a whole lot of experience. And you're going to tell us about why BIM is extremely important for anybody in the industry to at least be BIM conversant at some level in order to ensure that you have a job in the future. Or you come with me and the coffee.
And I might actually keep the question answers right to the
end. Yeah, the questions, yeah, should be like everybody, and then the questions at the end, because I'm sure the questions will be very extensive. So it will be yourself, and then Emma, and then we'll
open. I'm sure that there are lots of questions to be asked, Naima.
Sure. That's why it's best to keep it at the end.
Okay. So, hello everyone, assalamu alaikum. As you know, my name is Imran, and I've been working with the Arab Engineering Bureau for the last 3.5 years. Recently, I resigned from there, and I'm going to join a contractor, and I'll be working on a stadium project. So I'm looking forward for that opportunity, and in that way, I'll be able to complete my experience right from being an academic, right from being a researcher in building information modeling, then being an academic, and then working for a consultant. Please come in. Then working for a consultant, implementing building information modeling across different disciplines, and also for site team. And then now, after I join a contractor's company, I'm expecting to complete all those missing things which I was not able to observe or experience firsthand while working with consultants. So, as you know, LOD 400 thing is something which comes from contractor. And then further, we develop the models and building information modeling overall to LOD 500 level. And these are the things which I'm looking forward to experience firsthand, though I have implemented, but I have never seen the outcome of these implementations. So here I am. What I'm going to do here is based on the feedback we received from the registration you guys have done on the OMMR website, you sent us your idea that what you want to gain from this presentation, what are your main objectives which you want to take away from here. So in that way, I have named this presentation as Road to BIM. And as you know, we are four teams together here. Many thanks to Jamal to organize all these things at Qatar University. Jamal is a president of Qatar BIM, and myself as a vice president of Qatar BIM. Then we have got Umema. She has been very, very great in organizing all these things. Mm-hmm. Architects Hub, she represents Architects Hub, and Architects Hub has come like a sphinx from the sand. And last year I did not know anything about Architects Hub, and now this year Architects Hub is everywhere. So they are playing a very, very good role in bringing architects together and establishing a platform for architects to connect and network. Then we have got Doha BIM User Group, where I posted this event, and I think many of you may have registered from there. Then we have got BIM Arabia. We have got Mr. Omar Salim among us, and he is most respectful person here. He has been editing, he has been collecting the information about building information modeling. Then we have got Mohsin Al-Banna as well. He has been regular contributor for BIM Arabia magazine. And BIM Arabia in English is, I think, is a very, very huge initiative to for all those non-Arabic speaking people working in the MENA region to know about building information modeling and how to implement it, and then to be in touch with the recent trends and technologies in the field. Now, next slide is BIM Talk and why you are here. What I have done here is I've collected the feedback which we received from the registration forms, which show that what exactly you wanted to get here. So most of the people, they say that they want to get the basic ideas about building information modeling. What are the ways to achieve qualification or experience in the building information modeling, and how to reach there? So, and then many people are here to form networking, to know each other, to know the contact that how they can be picked up to do a BIM job. And then there are some people who really want to get into depth of the building information modeling concepts. So based on this thing, I prepared a very short presentation. This is only a 15-minute presentation where I'm going to focus only on two items. One is the core concepts of building information modeling. The other is level of detail or level of development. People are confused with this thing. And then we will talk a little bit about that what you have to get or what you have to achieve or what you have to, you know, certify yourself with in order to get into this field and to progress further. Okay, so key BIM concepts. First of all, BIM is not a software. This is something which we have to make ourselves understand. And most people think that if they are working on a software, for example, Revit, they are working in BIM. Whereas BIM is much more broader, much more wider than just a software. Secondly, software applications, yeah, they do. They form your founding, building block. But they are not BIM themselves. So there are different software applications which form BIM environment, and there are several processes around it. And when we implement those processes, then overall, including softwares, data and processes, we call it building information modeling. Play. Come on. Move. Sorry, that's technology. So. For some reason, this animation is not playing. What it is showing here, that this orange is rotating here and it's coming up with a bottle of jam. So I don't know why it's not playing. Maybe this browser is not compatible. But what it's showing here, this orange is rotating here and then out of it is coming a jam of a bottle. And I want to ask you that what is behind the overall thing, how you get a bottle of jam? Let's start a very small, short discussion. So first you pick the oranges from the orchards, right? Then what you do? You peel them off, you make a pulp of it, you take off the juice, and then what you do? To make a jam, what of the jam?
Sugar.
Sugar, and then cook it, and then make some, add some other recipes as per the jam, and then package it, and then put the labels on it, and market it. All those things are involved in preparing one bottle of jam. So there's lots of processes and procedures to follow to get that bottle of jam. What do you see here? Blank screen, right? Okay, there you've got a nice building. A starting model showing services. Then we've got foundation pillars. Then we've got more services added. More services added. I'm sorry for the speed because it is a little bit jerky here, but otherwise it is very smooth. So you get a structure. You get some more components added to the model, then you start getting the skin, further structure added, and then you get complete buildings, including facade and skin. So this is one of the projects I worked on called Alfa Dan Tower. So why I'm showing you here, this is to make you understand and compare with the bottle of jam and this building. So the overall processes we applied to produce that bottle of jam, something similar we apply here to create this set of models and to call it building information modeling. Again, a blank screen. What you see here is BIM sitting in the center, and we have three things around it. It starts with the process, and then it starts with the 3D, then it goes to 3D model, and then after that we get database. So when you call building information modeling, we have to set up the processes around it. And what those processes include? These are a few of the steps which we call processes, but if you actually dig down deeper into building information modeling, you'll get lots more information. So first of all, BIM calls for an integrated approach. That if teams are not under one roof, at least they should be connected via some sort of medium where they can easily collaborate, communicate, and work on the project. Number two is BIM has sprouted the idea of common data environment, which is the process of binding the teams in a collaborative environment. So common data environment, or CDE, is the concept which comes from BS 1192, British Standard 1192. And based on this, they call for an environment to be formed where information travels from one medium to other medium in a very constructive and defined way. So it calls for a four-way or five-way route where information is added first as a non-verified information, and then it goes to a verified information, then it is shared. So if you have been working in the building information modeling, you would have heard about WIP, work in progress, and shared. So these are two key concepts. Work in progress is a non-verified information, and shared is a verified information which you share between your team, among us, your team, and then outside your offices with clients and other stakeholders. So CTE in itself is a very detailed big topic. If we get another opportunity, we will talk only about CTE and how to establish it. Then another process is to define the stages of maturity through LOD. We'll talk more about LOD because this is one of the most talked about topic within building information modeling, and then there's lots of confusion about it, whether it is level of detail or level of development. Then BIM-based workflows help organizations to improve the information exchange and strengthen the IT infrastructure. So what many people understand about BIM is that once Revit is installed on the machine, they are working BIM, which is not right. Because to establish a BIM environment, you have to set up some sort of IT network, some sort of server where all the systems are connected and the information is centrally stored and shared. And then you are working in a collaborative environment. Again, this topic is quite big, and I have prepared another presentation which I presented at a Robert organized event, Doha BIM User Day, where I presented that topic where IT infrastructures are connected and information is stored, and then how people work in a collaborative manner. So all these are the processes. Once these are implemented, and then you start modeling, then you start producing modeling models in a constructive and a design and a very, very, very planned way. So I want to show you the slide here where while working with AEB, I have worked on these documents. These are policy and protocol from AEB, and then AEB manual is it consists of AEB BIM standards, then naming conventions, then BIM component library, BIM execution plan template. So BIM execution plan is one of the keystones when you start working on a building information modeling. Then if you already have all those key points covered in a template, then you can easily use that template and develop your project for BIM execution. Then we have got BIM contract documents, that how we exchange the information with the stakeholders, what are intellectual property protection, how we are going to protect that, and how we are going to share the information, what will be the source of sharing, either we're going to share through CDE or we are going to share through cloud. So there are different ways of doing that. And then BIM coordination strategy, that how we are running the coordination. It is not simply that you export the model to NWC and start using it in NEBI's work and then you are doing the coordination. But before that, you have to do a hell lot of exercise to define that how you are going to conduct that coordination. So you have to prepare element interaction matrix, and then you have to prepare the template for NEBI's work where you have got all your search sets and clash detection tests and all those things. Then you bring your models, and then you will be able to run the coordination in a purposeful way where you can get some concrete results. So that's about process. Now let's talk about BIM as a 3D model. So once you have implemented all those processes we discussed earlier, you get a model, and when we can, quite confidently, we can call it intelligent model. Because when you work in a BIM environment, it's quite different than what you work in CAD. Because in CAD, if you are drawing a line to represent a wall, it does not know that it is a wall. Okay, you define it that these two lines, they represent a wall. Whereas in BIM environment, if you draw a wall, it is only a wall. You cannot use it for anything else. And wall know that it is a wall. If you put a door on a wall, door know that it's a door. You cannot use the door in place of a window. Similarly, if you start placing a ceiling, right? Ceiling knows that it's a ceiling and it has to be a certain height. If the height is not being met, it will give you a certain kind of warning. You cannot use a ceiling instead of in the place of floor. It will raise some kind of warning that you are using something wrong. So in that way, when we produce building information models, they are intelligent models. Parametric architecture, structure, and MEP components. Parametric means there are lots of parameters in each component. If you are using a door would have parameters like the normal parameters, height, width, thickness. Then other than that, it will have fire rating, it will have finishes and different sort of parameters. It has graphical and non-graphical information embedded in it. So if you see a door as a 3D, that's a graphical thing. And if you click on it and then you go to the properties, you see lots of non-graphical information associated with it. And then both type of information are interlinked. If you go to the property, then change the width of the door in the 3D model, that will change. So that information is interlinked. Then once you have this thing ready, then you are actually preparing a database, BIM database, from where you can extract any kind of information. You can extract plans, elevations, sections, details. You can zoom in, or you can blow up a certain area. You can see what details are there. You can put the annotations over there. And then you can create a schedule, extract the schedule of anything which is there in the model. You can create schedule within like a click of a mouse. Otherwise, in the CAD environment, you are first counting all the doors on a floor, and then you're preparing schedule. Then you are copying and pasting from drawing to the schedule, and it takes lots of time. Whereas in BIM environment, you just go to the schedule, click select the door, and in one click, you can have all the schedule ready. And that schedule, which is the database and the model, they are again interlinked. If you change anything in the schedule, it is also changing in the model. So that's the key concept about building information modeling. Then, since all components can be made parametric, it means any information can be embedded in the model, such as OmniClass specification or COBE or any coding for NRM, that is new rules for measurement for quantity surveyors. So since all the objects in the model, they are parametric, which means you can create parameters and you can associate those parameters to the model. That means you can create any type of document for COBE, for NRM, for specifications. So it just increases your area of work wherever you want to work or whatever you want to create. It just have enormous potential there. Again, if you're talking about a specification, the traditional way of working or creating a specification is architects and engineers, they just send a whole lot of drawings as a hard copy to the specifier, and then they spend lots of time, many weeks, to create a document which is not directly linked to the drawings. So if architects or engineers, they are changing the specification in the drawings, it is very hard for specifiers to pick up those changes and update their specifications. Whereas in BIM environment, there are several software, there are several add-ins which can be installed with your main authoring tool, for example, with your MicroStation, such as e-specification, e-spec. So if you are following certain rules or certain ways of modeling, you can satisfy the requirement for e-specification. While you're modeling, your e-specification is also getting ready. And this is something which is based in the cloud. So there's a master document in the cloud, and if you are following the code from the specification, you're entering those code as the parameters. Building information modeling will pick up those parameters, will connect it to the database in the cloud, and will prepare your presentation, will prepare your specification. Again, if you're changing anything in the model, since specification is directly connected to your model, that will also be updated. So that's the beauty about building information modeling. So at a very conceptual level, this is what I wanted to explain to you. Next thing is the BIM environment. So as we discussed earlier, that Revit BIM authoring tool, where you produce the models, is a founding block, that's right. So at the top, we have those applications, for example, Revit, ArchiCAD, MicroStation, then there are several other softwares from different vendors. For Revit, we have got Architecture Structure MEP all combined in one. Similarly, within MicroStation, we have got all three disciplines together. ArchiCAD also does the same thing. There are other softwares such as Tekla. Then we have got Gehry, Digital Project. There are many softwares which form your which work as your authoring application. From there, what we do is, through interoperable format, we take the information in the form of models to other analysis software. For example, if we want to do a structure analysis, we take the model to ETABS. And ETABS, we can run our analysis. It works both ways. Most engineers, the structure engineers, they start their work in ETABS, and then they connect it to Revit. So the model is transferring both ways. So as soon as you are updating your model in ETABS, it is also updating in Revit. So there's a two-way connectivity. Similarly, using the, and then what are the interoperable format is something like IFC, if you have heard about it, Industry Foundation Class. That is the interoperable format which can be read by many different BIM applications. There are also formats, for example, DWF. Again, it's an Autodesk proprietary one, but it is interoperable. It can be read by many different applications from different vendors. Similarly, if you want to do energy analysis, again, using GBXML is another format, interoperable format, which these type of applications use to get the model into their interface. For example, Ecotech, then they have got Energy Plus, then there are several other software to do the job. Then we have got Dialux. Dialux, it calculates your lux level in the buildings, in the rooms, in the enclosed areas. So with the help of interoperable formats, we can do the analysis for the model and can get the result and then update the model. So similarly, when we take the model for 4D operations, 4D and 5D, this is again a big topic. 4D, when we add time-related information to a 3D model, we call it a 4D. And when we add cost-related information to the model, we call it 5D. So there are many 4D applications, such as Navisworks, Solibri Model Checker, WICO Office. So similarly, we export the model from Revit in NWC format to bring it into Navisworks. Similarly, for Solibri Model Checker, it uses IFC Industry Foundation Class. And for WICO Office, it can read the native format from Revit, but it is also good in reading DWF, DXF, DWG. It can read different formats. So all these interoperable formats, models can be generated in the authoring tools and can be transferred to these applications. Similarly, for 5D BIM, they've got different applications, Costex, Innovia, they have got BIM Major. There are other software which have recently came into on the horizon. WICO Office is a 4D and 5D combined application, very, very strong application to do both jobs together in one interface. So that's the BIM environment. As you can see, that there are so many things which you can do. I have not covered everything. We have yet to talk about 6D, 7D, 8D. We are not talking about facilities management, that how the models are updated within the same environment from LOD 350 to LOD 400 and then to LOD 500. Then we are not talking about 7D can be for fire rating, 8D could be for anything. So in the BIM theory books, you would see 3D and building information modeling as defined from 3D to 4D to 5D to NFT. So industry is still debating that what 6D should actually be standing for. If 6D is for facilities, then 7D can be for something else, or 7D, like for example, fire rating should be at the design stage, and fire rating should come before the facilities management. So perhaps these two I'm not sure whether 7D will be taken over by facilities management. Anyway, that's not a debate. Sustainability. Here you go. So 7D will be fire, then 8D will be for facilities management, then it can go to any extent. Now, understanding the mysteries of LOD. Audience, LOD, what do you think LOD is?
Level of detail.
Level of development.
How many say level of detail? Raise your hands. 1, 2, 3. Only three? Level of development? How come? Like you have to be like half and half. Yeah, okay. So this is the mystery, because it's a very confusing acronym, LOD. Straight away it goes, our mind goes to level of detail, because we are working in the BIM environment, we are working on the detail. But actually, as defined by BIM forum specification, LOD stands for level of development. So if you probe down further, it is a combination of information level of detail plus element level of detail. So the next slide is showing the relationship between these things. LOD is actually level of development, which is the combination of ILOD and ELOD. ILOD is information level of detail, and ELOD is element level of detail. So this is a very fine line difference between these three acronyms. I think I'll have to use your sketches to define or to explain you well the difference between these three. Black would be more visible. So we talked about LOD, which you know is level of
development.
Development, right? And this is a combination of I L O small o D plus E L small o D. This is how I try to define or I try to identify that what I'm saying. So ILOD is information level of detail as written there on the board, and ELOD is element level of detail. So if I'm saying LOD 100, what it means? It means that when I'm, so first I'll be defining ELOD. So at LOD 100, a wall would simply look like this in a section and in a plan, right? And at ILOD, ILOD is the parameter power, remember. When we talked about processes, we said that there are graphical information and non-graphical information. They are both interlinked. So this is the graphical information. You're seeing two lines which are representing wall. You can easily recognize it as a wall. But at ILOD, because this is a very, very starting level, for example, this is this, not for example, but it is actually concept design stage. And at concept design stage, architects and designers, they are just busy developing the layout of the building, right? So at this point, they will only be concerned with basic information about such as height, width, and thickness. So at this point of time, they will define height, for example, 3 meters. Width could be, thickness, they will define thickness here. And thickness would be, for example, 150 mm. They're not concerned at this point that what this wall would be, whether this is going to be masonry or this is going to be a timber wall or what wall. Because concept is more important at that point. So this is the basically ILOD parametric part, and this is the ELOD, which is the graphical part. At LOD 200, this is basically coincide with the schematic design stage. What do we define here? We define that, okay, this is the wall, and these are the finish. This is, for example, insulation, and this is the final finish, and from inside, this is the finish. So this is inside, and this is outside, okay? And here, they have defined height, which was already defined, 3 meter, thickness was already defined, 150 mm. Now they have also defined fire rating, and they have also defined finishes. For example, there may be a few more parameters over there.
And the material source.
Finish it.
No. In the data, the material, no.
They may say that, okay, this is a concrete block wall. They may say, at schematic design stage, they may be clear that this is a block wall. So this is kind of information which you'll get under ILOD at LOD 200, which is schematic design stage. Come to LOD 300. They will define, okay, this is my 150 mm block wall, this is the insulation, this is the outside finish, and this is the inside finish. And then, what else can we define at this stage? Colors, yeah, finishes, colors are already defined, but further details, like how the details about, for example, we have to add manufacturers.
Quantities.
After, because we already have these things here: height, thickness, fire rating, finishes, and then we can also define that reinforcement.
All these numbers are national standard, or I decide is LOD 300.
These are defined. These are defined.
International.
These are all. From if you take BIM specification and BIM forum, they have defined, but they do not define. This is the thing. This is the key thing to understand.
300 is I expect define the client, and I ask you, so you give me BIM model and the level of detail 300.
Yeah,
it's international. It's acceptable.
Yeah.
If I ask for this.
Yeah. So for if you go to BIM forum specification, they have got one document called BIM LOD only. They have defined level of detail and level of development. They have tried to, create a difference between the two things. But there's another document in Excel format, where they define that at LOD, these parameters are required.
My question is, this cost of $300 to $500 is totally different. As a client, price for $300 or $100.
As a client, it depends.
It's
okay.
Totally different the cost.
No, it's not. So consultants will be starting with from the concept stage, and they will obviously be starting from 100. But consultants, they finish their job at already 300. They do not provide any further information from that point of words, because contractors, they take it forward, and they develop the model sometime from already 350 and 400.
Yes, but if I have one good contract coach that to build, I can do it with 100. It's not cheaper for me.
And a major project is very difficult.
It's in the
strategic project, you need that level of detail, 300, in order to, you know, because in the United States, for instance, we link the level of development with the divisions. So we need that high level of details in order to meet the code and the regulation out there.
Yeah.
So major project, commercial, I would say.
Cannot be done
in 100.
Maybe private, somewhere house. Yes.
Yes.
Okay. We
do the questions
on
the
end.
I'm already running
late. So, okay, I need to finish this thing up. So, I think this is LOD, and we have covered the basic concept about LOD. If there are some confusions, we can discuss it. So, BIM is here, and BIM is definitely the future. So, the statistic which I have here. That is that all government projects from Ajwal, buildings, infrastructure, utilities, they are all being done in Revit, in BIM environment. All land use planning from Manatek is one of the government body, and they are developing economic zones for industries and for different type of tenants. Then metro lines, stations, and transit oriented development, they are all being done in the building information modeling. In fact, Qatar Rail has one of the most rigorous requirements for building information modeling. They have developed a set of documents which they call Qatar Rail BIM guidelines, prepared by Autodesk, and they are a set of about 44 documents. And then Qatar Rail team is very, very closely following the implementation process, and they are checking the model, they are checking the documentations. So if you have got the opportunity to work for Qatar Rail project, it will be a lifetime opportunity to understand the employer information requirement, and then how the all those requirements are implemented on the project. Then we've got Supreme Committee, all FIFA stadiums. I had the opportunity to work on fifth pressing Al Sumama Stadium, and I know that how particular they are when it comes to the implementation of building information modeling, and then the final output they are getting. Quite promising with Supreme Committee. Then we got LoSAL, Master Planning, Infrastructure and Building. They are all being done in the Building Information Modeling. In fact, we have Robert here. He represents Octave, and he is also one of the BIM faces in Qatar. He has been instrumental in preparing the BIM implementation document for LoSAL. Am I right, Robert?
We were involved in that.
And then we've got HMC, Ahmed Medical Corporation. Though they work through Ajwal, but they have got their own set of requirements, which form employee information requirement. And I worked on the emergency department, which is under construction. And it was a very, very promising project to understand overall BIM implementation. Now, Qatar Foundation, master planning, infrastructure, and all buildings, they are being done in the BIM environment. Qatar University, I was part of one of the parking buildings somewhere. It is under construction. We implemented building information modeling. We ran very, very successful coordination process after developing the process, of course. And then we have got Pearl Qatar, and then there are corporate clients, for example, Barwa. There are certain other clients who specifically require building information modeling to be implemented on their project. Unfortunately, due to current political crisis, there's some slowdown in the market, but whenever it picks up, whenever we are back to normal, there's going to be lots and lots of demand for BIM-based workforces and expertise. So how to get there, right? Build your own path to BIM. Plan out your career, because I've got lots of questions over there that how to get there. Are there any qualifications? Are there any certifications available? What is the job scenario? How quickly we can get there? So I, based on those questions, I have put up these points over there. Plan out your career, what you are, and where you want to head to. So you have to analyze yourself, you have to analyze your current working scenario, and then what exactly you want to be. The bright future in the field of BIM, if you build your path right way, if you are a modeler, master at least two authoring software and one coordination software. So if you are from design side, you got to be working in Revit, because Revit is one of the most popular tool here in Qatar. And then alongside, you have to know something about, for example, MicroStation, something about Tekla, something about digital project, because from time to time, there are requirements to work on this project. And then one coordination software. Either you master yourself in Navisbook, or you master yourself on Solar Remote Checker, SMC. If you are an architect, start designing in the BIM environment. That's the number one thing and most important thing. Architects think that they are architects and they are supposed to work only on papers. But they don't know the potential of these softwares which can provide, we can open the gate, like of, you cannot imagine the power of visualization these software presents. And then, yeah, author your design in one of those BIM applications. If you are an engineer, learn a BIM compatible analysis tool. For example, structural engineer, you got to know about ETABS. If you are a mechanical engineer, you need to learn some software. There's a plugin which goes with the, I forgot the name, but there are certain plugins which you need to learn about, and then at least one authoring platform. Then you got to explain the LODs and the underlying principles, and then how you're going to monitor it. So find your way to be a BIM coordinator, and then pave it further towards establishing yourself as a BIM manager. Understand BIM, understanding BIM requirement, employer information requirement, like I discussed before, Qatar Rail BIM guidelines, or from Supreme Committee, they have given a set of documents. Then implement build BIM execution plan and train your teams. So like we discussed before, that I have prepared a very detailed BIM execution plan template. So you got to start working on that, how you can prepare your own template, and then what kind of information should be there in the BIM execution plan for you to successfully work on that. And then you should be able to train your teams. So that's how you can build your own path towards future BIM positions. Currently, Robert is also hunting to hit like BIM experts and to take for a responsible position. You can be in touch with him. So, this is about this presentation. Be on top with BIM. High positions require higher education. Acquire certificates from authoring platforms. Enroll for master's course majoring in BIM. Attend CPD programs from various BIM bodies, primarily European, for example, RICS. Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, then BRE, British something. So they offer courses, they offer certifications, right? And then there are certain other, for example, Azure. They are BIM school. They are giving degrees and certificates in the building information modeling. Then to work in Qatar for BIM managers, there have been some demand for UPDA certification as well. And then read Bilasuka. This is one most important thing. As Jamal and Atif discussed, Bilas Sukar has got his own website, Change Agents, and there's another website where he puts his blog. Yeah, so it's a very, very good resource to learn about BIM right from the concept stage to the implementation stage. And then there's a free assessment tool over there just to assess yourself at where you stand. And then, yeah, thank you so much. I'm sorry, Mama. I'm taking almost